Hey everybody out there in Facebook land, it's Bowden Not Broken, the Daily Ben, and I have Nicole today. Pretty special little show. As you know, on the Daily Ben, I like people to tell their stories and how their progression through life, but today's kind of a real special one. Nicole's going to tell you about kind of her last several years and what she does now, and kind of the influences she has on people's lives. So again, anybody that joins us, this is live, this is just, you know, production value is always the, but I appreciate Nicole having me here. It's been a good little while, and I wanted to just kind of start by tell us what has happened to you over the last, you know, as many years, and how that changed your life.
Seven years ago, I crossed over, and it was from a drug and alcohol overdose. So what happened is I had cancer cells removed. So I went to the doctor went into surgery, and I went back and drank the same amount of alcohol that I usually drink, and at this time I crossed over. It was an amazing experience because I got to go into the white light and understand that that light is so masculine and it is so feminine, and it is the most amazing love you've ever felt in your entire
life. So in other words, you died.
I died, yes.
Okay.
Crossed over.
Okay.
So this time I got to see my past, present, and future, and then I came back to a broken body. I came back to a body that I couldn't walk, I couldn't communicate, and I could hear the doctors talking and my family talking about how, like, what to do with me, kind of put me in bed, and they made plans to assist me for the rest of my life. And that wasn't going to work with me, because I saw my future. I saw what I get to do, and I could not do that in a broken body. So I chose to stay in the white light. And I chose to learn the body. I choose to learn this energy that's so available to everybody. And it's, so I go in, I every day I would just work on it. And eventually I was able to just roll out of bed, and I would move to the stairs against my family's will. At this time I already broke my nose from falling out of the bed. And then I eventually got to the end of the stairs, and then I would start to move up. And then all of this against all the I fell on the stairs three times. They told me to go back to bed. And if I would have listened to the doctors and came to the understanding that that hurts and that you shouldn't do, I wouldn't be where I'm at today. And that's why I think I'm so thankful I got to see my purpose that I'm doing now. So at this time, I started walking and I started talking, and I was trying to express to my family and about how amazing this experience was, and that I could see these angels or these lights or this amazing light that whatever it looks like to you, it's the God, it's creator, it's that amazing love that is within. And I tried to explain this to them, and they didn't understand it, nor did they believe me. So this time I went, and I had to kind of go through a process of going back, walking in the dark for a minute. And so through that process, I learned many, many lessons. And then I got the opportunity to go to, so I was at the state of being when I'm talking to my family and I'm telling them, I see this, I do this, and they're scared of me. And
everybody
so
thinks you're crazy. You've lost it.
Yeah. And I do too.
Right. Right.
And this time
you're watching the Daily Bend, and I'm with Nicole, and she's telling her story about, she crossed over, and actually, you know, if we've had a whole lot of time, a couple times that's happened, but kind of getting back to the whole time when your family, you're trying to understand what's going on, your family's trying to go, oh, wait a minute, has she lost her marbles? Has she gone, you know, somewhere weird? Anyway, sorry, I have to kind of throw it in there every once in a while, but, so continue from there. Family's kind of struggling. You're struggling with you too. And how does that progress?
Well, when you're balancing this consciousness, and then that a lot of people that have the and that have crossed over come back right. with, and then when you're balancing this consciousness, that even people that have come back with that are in similar situations don't relate to how long I was gone, 7 to 10 minutes. And so as I'm working with my family, and they're not believing me, I started to doubt myself, which is causing tons of disharmony in my own body, and I didn't want to live anymore. So I said, I tried to commit suicide, and it didn't work. And so, I mean, I don't have fear, I didn't come back with fear.
Right.
And.
But when you came, you may have covered it, you had to relearn how to walk, mm-hmm. you had to relearn how to basically talk. Mm-hmm. And read and all those types of things, and you just reached a point in your life where you were like, I'm done. I just mm-hmm. don't understand all this, and mm-hmm. okay.
Well, what it was is other people were telling me I didn't understand it.
Oh, okay.
I'm moving through trying to do.
So this is your experience, and people are trying to tell you what you experienced?
Yeah.
Okay, that's interesting.
Like, that can't be, that couldn't happen. You right. can't, they didn't agree with, I mean, some people don't believe that there's angels. I mean,
right,
that's okay.
Right.
And even if people seem different, a light, an angel, whatever it looks like to you, certain people do feel it and experience it. You feel them. They're there.
Right.
The energy's there. So there's no denying the energy's there. Now we're in our. Now they're like, well, okay, we feel that something. We feel something different. Now there's this trying to understand what's around me causes a negative energy, and which should have been something very positive.
Right.
So I'm like, you know what, I don't want to live anymore. So I tried to commit suicide. And when it didn't work, I asked my family, said, put me into the ward where there's the depression and
typically called the psych ward.
Yeah.
Right.
And like, put me there because right. I knew in 30 to 40 days that somebody there would tell me what was wrong with me. Somebody there would tell me what was wrong with me, or the angels and the lights would still be there. So I put myself into the psych ward, and at this time there's this book called The Four Agreements, and I go in there and I grab it, and I understand I can't read. Like, I can write some things, I can maybe sign my name and do things that but I can't read a book. So I kind of skimmed through that and kind of applied it, and I'm so open to learning because I'm still, that consciousness is still there. So I'm so open to learning, and then the next day the people ask if anybody from the psych ward want, or the patients want to teach, because that's how they get people to interact and mm-hmm. to have mm-hmm. confidence again. And if mm-hmm. you're in depression, you know, play the piano and things like this. And so I thought I would teach what was in the book. So the whole 30 days, every day I taught something out of that book. And at the end of my 32, 33 day, when I was let go, everybody went with me. Never happened. So at that time, I'm like, I know my purpose. There has to be something with this. So I come home and I come to the understanding that my family still doesn't believe what's going on. So
And what is it there? What is it they don't believe that you have? What do you call it? Do you call it different perception, different abilities, different, you know, what do you call it that they're into contrast with you?
So when I come back with a direct connection and an energy that's so intense that when I lift my hands up, things are moving. And that's only because I sat in this room for a couple of years with all this energy, just still connected to the white light. I never left it, and I still don't.
Right.
And I have all this energy, and it's moving, and then they become scared of me because I'm different. Something's different about me.
Right.
And it becomes scary.
A lot, like a lot of folks out there, not in this particular situation, but
yeah.
we're all different in mm-hmm. a sense, but yours is a pretty interesting divine type thing as well, you know?
So as I'm assisting people, I find that I got a really dramatic experience so people could really see, because they're little, people have these little experiences all the time, but they kind of dismiss them as not important or they don't come to understanding. Yeah, mine's drastic because it's showing how people treated me for being different, but then a couple years later come to me for assistance, you know? And so I really think that this, as my work goes on and we work with people, will come to that understanding that mm-hmm. this whole thing obviously had a reason to mm-hmm. be done. But.
So you're watching The Daily Bend. We have Nicole here, and Nicole has, she's talked a little bit about her her story wanted to continue. So you get back from the psych ward, and the whole family's kind of still fighting that whole thing. Then what happens? Where do you go from there?
Well, I decide I'm gonna be normal.
You're gonna be normal. I'm gonna go back to be normal. Okay.
I'm gonna get a job. So I go to this kid's store, and they take older clothes and they sell them for a good value. And so I go in and I can do that, right? And I can put the do all stuff. But I got hired as manager. So I put a little bit of a wrench in there, because the first day I got there, I was able to connect with him, and it happens that he knows my mom. His wife and my mom were friends.
Okay.
And like growing up or something. And so I come home and I said, "Mom, he wants to help me." He says to come, and that they would go through a past life or a spiritual journey, whatever it takes, just to see what this energy is, and you know why I'm so sensitive and hear and see all this stuff. And so we go there, and at first I just kind of go into my same meditation, and I go into the same light, and I just wait to hear what they say, because I've been called crazy for 7 years, you know, on and off for this time. So I'm like, so I go into that space, and then my mom, which struggled coming, because her belief system doesn't really believe in past life. So her beliefs,
as a lot of religion, some religions don't. Okay.
So she was hesitant to come, and she, at the last minute, she was also guided to go. Mm-hmm. So it was her, two gentlemen, that one I only met once at the store, and the other one I had never met. And he goes on, goes on spiritual journeys, so he can see what your journey that you're going through. And they have a lot of people have been doing it for years. And the other one's a hypnotist, and he feels and he sees a little bit. So anyways, we go in there, and I just wait. I just go into my consciousness, go into the white light, and they're doing their thing. And then all of a sudden, I hear my mom just bawling. So I just come present with her for a minute. And then the other guys are crying. And they ask my mom, "What do you see?" And she says, "She's kneeling in front of God. She's in the white light, kneeling in front of God with music notes going around her." And I'm like, "You can see me?" Because this has been a 7-year process for me. And for someone to actually see me, and it becomes real. And then the ones that don't even know me are telling my story. I mean,
so this amazing validation, basically, and your progression through, and I'm not trying to preempt, but your progression through the confidence that you had in what you really experienced and how you can help people, you know, in other ways, started to probably happen at that time. Was that the time you put the kind of the light bulb went on?
Yeah, and they had a voice recorded it, and I had to actually listen to it like over and over again really be present with that it really happened.
Right.
Because, I mean, 7 years means something's wrong with you, you know, something's wrong because of this and because of that, whatever. I was like starting to build my confidence, but now I saw that someone else sees it, and they're strangers. There's not, no one's just supporting my story. Someone that completely didn't support my story because of the seeing the angels and doing certain healings and doing certain things that I had been doing, you know, and then two strangers that saw and felt as well. So from that day on, I chose to, one of their nieces was struggling. So we chose to do a kind of just a healing. I didn't know, I was just guided to do like this healing. And right later on, it's similar to what they call Reiki. Never studied it, didn't know anything about it, but that's what we did. And it went from 3 to 6 to 10 to 20 to however much it expanded in that group. But at this time, I'm just learning my energies, and I'm having this really high connection. And these people are more experienced than I am. And they started being resistant to me, and I started feeling really, really bad. And things that had been said, like that my energy is too high, and I don't really understand.
Your energy's too high.
I don't understand. So again, I'm like, oh no, something's wrong with these people that I love and respect.
Right.
Don't really want, my energy's too high, so something's wrong with me. So I'm going to move this direction and do what I'm guided to do and clear some energies up that I had to work with at the time.
Right.
And at this time I went to several different groups. I'm not going to name them, but I went to several different groups, and they weren't very kind to me.
Right.
They said, well, you have the connection. So I felt like maybe they thought I was testing them, but I didn't even know I had a connection.
Right.
Like, I didn't realize when they explained to me now that the connection on my head is like some people know energy is your third eye, but mine is on top of my head. And it's, and at this time I didn't know. So I got invited to go to the Parliament of World Religions. And this was...
Right. And that, yeah, you're watching Bow Not Broken, the Daily Ben. We're with Nicole, and we're talking about her, kind of her journey, her amazing journey, and where she has come to now. If you would, for the sake of time, because hopefully you'll have me back, or I can have you back on again. But that if you can tell the story. I've done a little homework about the monks. That would be a very telling story to tell. So maybe you went to the Parliament of World Religions and.
Okay. So I went there to get stories because somebody would be relatable to me and somebody would find
out. So you're going to find not only validation, but also, not necessarily validation, you're going to kind of go, wait a minute, am I like everybody else? Mm-hmm. Am I right? Because the Parliament of World Religions has a lot of different types of spiritual and organized religion type of things as well, right?
They do. 10,000 people.
And that was just this last year. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And 80 religions, which was really interesting why I was called there. And one thing I can tell you about that place is that me not knowing religions, because I lost memory of any teachings, I went into one of those places not understanding separation. And I can tell you that white light, that God light, that creator light that I was in for those 7 to 10 minutes is in every single one of those rooms. Every single one of those rooms.
So they all have it, right? Mm-hmm. In a way. They all have it. That's interesting. Mm-hmm. That's something I didn't do my homework on, but that's an interesting concept. They all kind of have it right, which is interesting. So your dealings with these holy men, right? I mean, we're talking monks, right?
So at the time, I didn't know what they were, but... In the morning, these monks will come through when they bless the place because they are not there during the main energies. They come in the morning and go at night. But my mom and I were getting some stuff ready and talking, and again, I don't really know what monks they were or anything because I never asked and I haven't really explored. So there's several guys that came, they sat in a circle in front of my mom and I. And one guy from the middle comes and asks if I will talk to the guy in the middle and tell him the story that I told the people the day before. And I'm like, oh, you bet. So they open up this kind of door, let me in, these people door, and I go sit down with a gentleman, and I come to find out that these monks are amazing. They are literally, they are born into this Montessori. They learn all these ancient teachings and hold all this amazing energies and shared with me that was their way of being.
Mm-hmm.
And then they asked me, translator, of course, asked me how, where I got my energy and had I had a, kind of asked my story, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And then he says, the translator says, do you know what you came back as? And well, no, I don't really understand.
What did I come back as? Yeah.
Yeah, I'm like, I don't really understand. And,
the pig.
Yeah, I'm like something wrong with me? Because I'm still in that state of being, you know, right. And he's like, he wants you to know that you came back as an angel.
You came back as an angel.
Mm-hmm. And he says, can he hug you?
Okay. Can he hug you? Monks don't hug. They don't hug. Mm-hmm. And especially women. Mm-hmm. So go ahead. Sorry.
So I hug him. And I walk out. And I start talking to my mom. And the guys are like, eyes are like, holy snap. Well, one transfer comes up and he says, you know what an honor that is? And mind you, I may have a huge, vast consciousness and I can go to every sacred geometric sign at this time and do all this stuff, but I don't have I'm only like a 7-year-old in a candy store.
Right.
And literally, think about a baby. It took him 18 months to walk.
Right.
I mean,
right.
I literally had to relearn everything. So so I don't know. And I'm just really excited that he even to even have the experience to tell the story. And he says that they then shared the information they don't hug and stuff. And they went on their own way. And then I went and told the story and caught more stories. So,
is it okay to say that you have a documentary that's going to come out eventually? Mm-hmm. She has there's been a international filmmaker that has done a documentary, and it will come out eventually, and we'll let everybody know when that happens. I don't know, there's a lot of folks out there that, I'm not trying to be, it's not in no way, what do you call yourself? You call yourself a healer, right? Mm-hmm. But it's not, I kind of made a joke a few minutes ago when I was, the healer that hits you on, evil spirits come out, not that, you're in the energy, the white light, the whole type of thing. How many people have you helped, over the last little while? I mean, we're talking hundreds, we're talking hundreds, right? I would imagine.
There's well over 350.
Well over 350. And I said I made the question, any unhappy customers? And really there aren't. I've done my homework as well. She doesn't know it, but I've done my homework as well. So what do you offer? And tell anybody if they're struggling with, what types of things are you helping people with? It's day 743 of pushing people out of darkness and depression. And I would imagine suicide or depression is one thing that you do help people with. But what are some other things that you help them with?
So what I call myself, I just want to clarify that, is I was having a hard time of who am I? What am I? The people are coming to me for these certain things and different things. So I went out to study Reiki, Qigong, Reconnection, Akashic Records. I did this stuff of trying to find who I am.
Right.
And people started calling me the spiritual healer. And that's when I'm like, wow. That's amazing because
right.
So when they started calling me that, I'm like, wow, I'm doing something different. I'm doing something right. And it took me slowing down and accepting these gifts.
Right.
And so when I started doing that, I started understanding the people that were coming to me were almost similar to things. I've gone through the suicide. I've gone through the addiction. I have gone through now the spiritual journey that I had to hit rock bottom. I had to go through all that, and people started coming to me, and just pulling them out of that and going through the sessions, and they're healed. I can't explain it, but it's working. Mm-hmm. So then we started writing them down, so then I would understand, because I just am going. I'm so excited about my work. I'm so excited to be here.
Right.
So then when I finally started writing them down and started understanding, wow. These people are saved, their lives are saved, and their testimonies are real, and it's not me doing it. I never say it's me, because, mm-hmm. but unlike on the healer, I know I show up.
Mm-hmm.
I know I show up, and so it does take energy to do that. So,
sure.
So being that healer knows that my I am respects and honors your I am,
right.
So we come to the understanding that without higher self, how God, I couldn't do anything.
Right,
so,
that is I am,
yeah.
I am, right?
Because I've been challenged on that, is taken, because I say I, but no, I honor myself, I honor my I am, and I honor your I am so much that I don't have to step over my words every time I say I. Does that
right,
make sense?
Right.
So as I started understanding the different kinds of energies, and I realized that the modalities and all these different things just came to me, like, instinctively. Then people started telling their stories, and I started understanding that it's amazing, and look what we're doing. Then this team that we've created, there's 25 to 30 to 50 that will show up any time, and they all want to learn this work. They all want to learn, because the most amazing thing is what I do is right there inside of you. It's available to anybody.
Mm-hmm.
There's no limits. There's a vast amount of love and unconditional love and healing out there.
So that's the humility in everything that you're doing. It's not just you. There's a lot of people involved in it. You're not like a faith healer that's, send me money and mm-hmm. that kind of a thing. That's kind of, I know that I'm trying to be a little bit silly, but a little bit honest. How can people get a hold of you? Obviously I tagged you on Facebook. And, social media is great nowadays for good, positive stuff. But they can get a hold of you this way. How other ways? I mean, I know you're on Instagram, you're on Facebook. And you, well, you can answer that question. How can they get a hold of you if they may not be on those social networks, or are there other ways?
We'll leave the phone number under. Is that okay?
Okay, so yeah, I can post the phone number.
But the one thing that I do want to share that's most amazing that just hit, these energies that are hitting, and that, again, it's the clients that are coming to me, mm-hmm. people that are coming to me, is Lyme's disease. And that has to really be understood, that there is other help out there. There's just the frequency and vibration that we're all made of is really what you make of it. Like, if mm-hmm. you can stand in that frequency, and if you can understand it, and you can begin that love, you can assist people. Mm-hmm. So I started with one client, and then two, then three clients, and it goes on and on. But the Lyme's disease, I can tell you that these clients have come and laid on my bed with swollen legs, it hits your autoimmune system mm-hmm. really, really bad, and then it causes a lot of sub illnesses. Mm-hmm. Well, their blood tests were positive for Lyme's, and after three times, none. No traces of blood. No traces in the blood in Lyme's. So it's working.
I know I have a few watchers, listeners, and one that was on the Daily Bend a long time ago, a year ago. I know she suffers from some of that as well. So maybe that can be a connection as well. So it's not just, in a kind of a pre-interview, you talked about you respect, you know, the addiction, the other addiction therapies as well. Yours, do you see yours as a complement to that as well? I mean, I know that, you know, there's some people that say, well, there's only one way, but are there other complements to, you know, those types of things? Does that make sense, that question?
To honor one's personality and one's space is to know that there's millions of people on this earth. How mm-hmm. can only one modality, one thing work for one person? So when people walk in they have a whole different energy. You have a different energy than no one else has the same energy.
Right.
There. What works for one person is never going to work exactly the same for another person.
Right.
And those, you can rename the disease to because it's run its term or whatever, and give more medicine, whatever you want. The thing is, it's because that you could, each one of those persons walk in with a different vibration, a different frequency, and they're going to handle your energy and your frequency different. So when we when these workers that work with me, mm-hmm. when people come in and I'm like, wow, look at them, you know, they're my clients. They're mine. I'm the one that travel all over the country to do this, right? I'm the one that has a documentary, and they're my friends. I could do that very easily. But no, because the person that walks through that door, if they resonate to one of the team members, and I'm frustrated about that, all I see is dollar signs. I don't care about that person. Therefore, I shouldn't call myself a healer.
Excellent. That was excellent. The reason I asked that question was because I think there are some people out there that are so, I think they have their, you know, their blinders on, that they think there's only one way, or you can't combine ways, or you can't, you know, different strokes for different folks. I mean, mm-hmm. I see it, you know, in the health world or the motivation world, it's the same kind of thing. Anything we didn't cover, we could do an hour or two with her, mm-hmm. and we will. But just this little, I think it's been about 20, 25 minutes. I wanted to put in your story and really kind of highlight, you know, the amazing things that you're doing and, you know, the amazing place that you've been. I mean, you've been to the dark side. You've seen all of that. And you're a normal person that, you know, grew up and did all those type of things. And all of a sudden, you know, you had these experiences that have changed your life but are changing other people's life. And that's why I wanted to highlight this. Is there anything that you'd want to, you know, say to anybody out there that might be considering something coming to somebody like you?
There are so many different workers, and there's so many different modalities that that can assist in so many ways. Some people think if they don't get immediate, like my energy offers immediate sometimes for mm-hmm. things, but there's people want, it's like this want for instant gratification, and if it didn't work the first time, you're not going to understand it. But these other workers that are offering their time and putting this energy in, those workers meditate all the time. It doesn't matter what they, if they're Reiki or if they're Qigong or they're yoga teachers. They have a connection. Their value. The thing that I don't understand is the value that people put on them. For me too, like people will come to me and I'll go and their son's alive now. Pulled the needle right out of his arm.
Mm-hmm.
But yet they don't want to. They can't express like the value exchange isn't there. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So these people understand to be able to have these connections, you do work morning, noon, and night to keep them. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't matter, again, what kind of, I mean, if it's working, it's working.
Mm-hmm.
So reach out to them.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. I know this is definitely out of, live TV is a little bit out of everybody's comfort zone. And so I just want to thank everybody for watching. Share it, like it. I'll throw it up on YouTube. I appreciate Nicole allowing me, and her husband to come in, to their space and talk about this stuff and really kind of understand it a whole lot more. And so hopefully we can every once in a while we can do some more. You split your time between here. Well, you don't split your time. You live in St. George, but you come up this way as well. So there is opportunity, in the upper northern Utah, Salt Lake counties, if people need you. And you're going to be doing a lot of things as time goes on in the future.
So the third Wednesday of every month, we do hold a gathering here in Utah County. So when I moved to St. George to work with Lyme disease and cancer,
mm-hmm.
when I started working there, because the energy there is amazing, down here it was just, people were calling and calling, and it's hard for them to get there. So I come here once a week or once a month.
Once
for
a month,
week
okay.
To
for a whole
those.
Week. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, and I'll put up the phone number, I've tagged her, and she's on Facebook, Instagram, and I'm sure other things. And I just really appreciate your time and effort and energy, and it's been
fun.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody, for watching. Hopefully, you'll join me again. Again, it's day 742 or 743. Reach out to somebody. Maybe reach out with and share this video. It might help somebody. It might save somebody's life. Bones. Thanks.
Thanks.